Hey everyone, welcome to this week's Azure Infrastructure Update. It's the 20th of November and quite a lot of updates this week. I suspect next week will be very quiet, given it being Thanksgiving in the US. As always, I have the chapters and new videos this week. So I'm trying something new. So I did get a video out about using multiple regions, considerations for architecture, thinking about, well, what if I'm not using the paired regions? But also on my last week's update, I actually created a version that's dubbed into Spanish. And so that was linked from the main video. And I'm gonna try and do that for all of my videos going forwards. And so there'll be translations. So if you actually go and look at audio tracks, you should also see Spanish. So Spanish and I think Portuguese will be the initial languages. There'll also be captions for those languages if you prefer the English audio but want the subtitles in a different language. As a side effect, I have to go and actually manually edit the English captions. So if you're hard of hearing and you use the captions should be a higher quality for my videos going forward. But this process takes some time. And that's why it's only one video this week. I did do another video, but it takes about 4 days for the complete process to go through this because I have to submit it, it generates a caption file, I then have to manually go and edit it, then I have to submit it, and then it does the translations, the dubbing, so it's about a 4 day lag now. What that means is, well, the Azure update, this, I have to put out on Sundays. There's not enough time to get the translation. And so there'll be another version of the Azure update each week, a couple of days later, that will have the multiple languages in it. So that's my plan going forward, is to try and just make it more available to more people, both those that rely on the captions more, but also dubbed and translated to different languages. And the number of languages will change as the service, the allowed service, actually opens up for more languages. So on to what's new. Azure Backup is now available for confidential VMs. This is the whole VM, like the AMD-based encryption, if it's using a platform-managed key. I cannot use a customer-managed key today, but if it's a platform-managed key, then Azure Backup will now work with those confidential virtual machines. ARM-based virtual machines are now available in additional regions. So ARM provides this fantastic price performance, and they've added West US, North Central US, UK South, and France Central. And I think there's now 15 regions that support zone specific deployment. So I can really get those availability zones to increase my all up resiliency, and AKS can now use these ARM-based nodes as well. Azure Functions now has a SQL trigger. So if I think about Azure Functions has different bindings for import, for output, and some of them it can trigger from. So now when I perform those create, update, delete operations on rows in a SQL Server database, well, Azure Function could now be triggered from that. Now it's only if I'm using the premium or dedicated plan of Azure Functions I can trigger. Any of the plans can bind to SQL Server for just regular input, output, but to trigger, I have to have that dedicated or premium plan. But yeah, now I could have an Azure function that, hey, I insert some record as part of some process. Hey, go and call the function for that record. Hey, I delete something, go update it. I can go and call a serverless function now to perform some action. On the networking side, so there's now a bot-managed rule set 1.0 for regional web application firewall. So regional means it adds on to app gateway. So that's the regional version of the web application firewall. And this is now in GA. So if I think about currently I've got core rule sets, I've got custom rules. Well, now I also have this managed set for bot protection. And it gives me three categories. I can think about good bots, i.e. maybe web crawlers, bad bots, I know they're from bad IPs or bad whatever that is, and then unknown. And I can set actions for those. So for the good bots, hey, allow it. For the bad bots, block it. For the unknown, maybe I just log those things. So I now have that available to me. Again, for regional WAFs, so again, part of App Gateway add-on, I now have rule-specific actions. So in the past, if we think about, hey, the core rule set and the bot rule set, we have multiple rules as part of those sets. And what I could do is I could enable or disable a rule. Well, now building on that, at that rule level, I could actually set different actions. So if it was the core rule set, well, maybe it's a block, maybe it's a log, maybe it's some anomaly score modification, If it's the bot at a rule level, allow block log. So I have a lot more granularity in what I want to do with those rules. Then App Gateway now has TLS 1.3 support in GA. Now this is for the predefined 2022, so the newer policies and my custom V2 policies. But now I can get that improved security, the performance of TLS 1.3. I do need the V2 gateway SKUs to be able to leverage that. On the storage side, some managed disks now support cross-tenant customer managed keys. That's GA. So there's been a whole bunch of announcements recently about cross-tenant around storage. Because the whole big deal is if I'm some sort of software as a service provider running in Azure and I have multiple customers, well, they may want to have control of the keys used to encrypt their data. So storage accounts have this, but now managed disks have this as well. So as part of my solution as a SaaS provider, I maybe have a managed disk in a disk encryption set per customer set of data. Well, now the customer can have the key in their key vault, in their subscription, in their tenant, but I can use that key for the disk encryption set, which contains the managed disk to control that customer managed key encryption. So now customers can keep hold of the keys that are securing their data. So it's gonna be a pretty big deal if I'm a SaaS provider. Huge number of database announcements all around Azure SQL. Now, all of these are GA announcements. So database, granular database restore progress. So now I can actually go and query this percent complete column out of the DM operation status dynamic management view. And it will show me between 1 and 99 how far along that restore progress is. Azure SQL Managed Instance now has this backup transparency. And what that basically lets me do is I can now go and get information from a table about the manual backups, about the automated backups. What was the type of backup? Was it a full, a differential, a log? And what was the time? What was the status? What replica was used to back up? I can now actually go and query those tables to get that information. Again, Managed Instance now has a log replay service. Log replay services enable me to do log shipping. So hey, I've got my logs, I'm gonna send them somewhere else, really for the purpose of maybe migrating databases. So hey, SQL Server 2008 through to 2022, I could now use the log replay service to get the data into an Azure SQL MI instance. Also, Managed Instance has cross-subscription point-in-time restore. So I have a restore point for my Azure SQL MI backup. I can restore it to a different subscription. Has to be same region, has to be the same Azure AD tenant, but it can be a different subscription. I have relaxed virtual network requirements. So the whole point of Azure SQL MI, well, one of the points, is it lives within my virtual network. I have greater consistency with just a regular SQL server in terms of the capabilities, the agents, and those things that are available to me. But it is running in my subnet, in my virtual network. And there were a set of routes and NSG rules I have to have. And some of them were fairly broad. And what they've done is make them more refined. So there's less chance of it maybe being misused or it's more flexible than you want it to be. So it's really cut down on the number of NSGs I need, number of routes I need, made them more specific. So there's less potential concern and overhead for me in my virtual network. There's an enhanced virtual cluster. So if I think about the SQL managed instances live within a virtual cluster, so that is one virtual cluster exposed per virtual network. And that has things like a version now, that has things like tag supported. So there's been just some modifications to how that functions, changes to how DNS is updated. I think it's asynchronous now, it used to be synchronous, but just some enhancements around those virtual clusters. I have backup portability. So hey, if I take an Azure SQL MI backup, if it's a copy-only full backup, I can restore that to a SQL Server 2022 anywhere I want. And SQL 2022 has gone GA as well. Out of the GA announcements, so Azure SQL Database now has external REST endpoint in preview. So from my Azure SQL Database using my Transact SQL, I can call any RESTful API directly from my Azure SQL Database. So there's this new SP invoke external REST endpoint available, and I just tell it, hey, the method, the URL, and where to store the response, just as part of my T SQL. So that's now in preview. For Azure SQL Managed Instance, I can now stop my instance. So if I stop, I stop paying the compute charge side of that. I'm still going to pay for the underlying storage. I'm still going to pay for my backups, but I'm going to stop paying that compute. Obviously, I can then start it again. There's zone redundant options for my business critical now to distribute those replicas over multiple availability zones to increase my resiliency. There's also a sub 30 minute creation time in a new subnet going to come mid-December for general purpose for 8V cores. There's a distributed transaction coordinator, so I can do those distributed transactions where a single transaction is going across multiple databases. So that transaction coordinator is going to enable that. So that's in preview as well. Azure SQL MI Managed Instance Link. So if I think about I have a SQL Server Availability group that encompasses my SQL instances, well, I can now extend that to have Azure SQL MI instances in that as well. So now I can have my data replication extended out to that SQL MI. This is going to be great for that one-way replication, not only for failover purposes, but maybe, hey, I'll use that as part of a migration as well. And then SQL running in an IaaS VM, I get these free DR replica capabilities. If I have software assurance, I only have to license the cores for the primary, the active instance of that SQL in the VM in Azure. I can have one passive secondary in the same region. I can't have workloads connected to it, so I can't be reading from it, for example, for analytics. I'd have to license it then. But if there's no workloads connected to it, I can have that passive instance in the same region, and I can have one in another region for DR, and I don't have to pay the licensing on that. When I have those instances, when I set the license type, there's a new disaster recovery choice, which then won't require me to have those licensed. Oh, an Azure Synapse link for SQL, that just enables the easy extraction and movement of data from Azure SQL Database and SQL Server 2022 to the Azure Synapse Analytics dedicated its own SQL pools. I don't require any extract, transform, load pipelines. It's near real time. So it just makes it really easy to get the data from my Azure SQL databases, hey, into my Azure Synapse Analytics dedicated SQL pools. Miscellaneous. So the Azure Resource Manager, that endpoint I use for my management interactions, will be TLS 1.2, probably above, only from fall 2023. So TLS 1.1 and older will all be deprecated. So you've got time, but make sure all my environments, my operating systems I use support TLS 1.2 or above. And there's now an Azure Quota RESTful API in preview. So when I have my subscription, there are certain limits that I have, number of virtual machines, other things. I can go to the portal, I can see those. I can put in a request to raise them. Well, now through this Azure Quota REST API, I can see what my limits are. I can see how much I'm using of those limits, and I can put in a request to raise those limits. So I can now programmatically think about all of those things. And that was it. As always, I hope this was useful. Again, the multi-language version will follow a couple of days later after I post this on Sundays. If you're in the US, have a great Thanksgiving, and I'll see you on the next video.